So, Marsha, you're a beautiful cellist, beautiful, beautiful to look at, I must say, and every, well, you know, also important, because you look beautiful, you look as though you are happy to be playing. So many people, when they play, look as though they wish they weren't there. You look as though you really wished you were there. It's beautiful. You have a gorgeous sound, beautiful control, and deep feeling, which is great. So what could we possibly add to what you're already doing? And I have an interesting idea. And I'm thinking of these two young guys and wondering whether they're going to be able to follow what we're going to do now. Because what you're doing is very beautiful, and if you could do it, just start it again, and I'll explain what it is that I think you're doing. Just start from the beginning. Okay, now do that phrase again, and I'm going to conduct it, okay? So you feel each beat like that, right? So maybe your toes, even inside your shoe, are going om, bom. Just do it again. Good. Now, I'm going to say something which you're going to spend the rest of your life thinking about, okay? And so is everybody else who's a musician here. I'm going to say something to you which I can't prove is true, but I'm going to say it, and you're going to think about it. All romantic music is in one. Mm. Right. All romantic music is in one. Now, if that's the case, instead of feeling wom, bom, bom, we're going to feel wah, doo, da, dee. Should we try that? And I can conduct it in one now. Right. And what happened there was amazing, because it wasn't in one, it was in half.
Yeah.
You feel that? I gave one beat and it took us all the way through the second bar. So we're going to do it again, and this time everybody in the audience is going to, instead of try and feel three while we're doing this. That's a different kind of music, isn't it?
Absolutely.
Absolutely different kind of music.
Yeah.
And it gives you actually much more freedom than you think you have.
Yeah.
Because instead of having to put the beats down like that, you can actually take an amazing amount of freedom. Should we try one more time? Also, in those days, musicians' string players used to slide more than they do now. We've become so Puritan. It was, ooh, got to be pure. But they weren't pure. No. They felt things, and singers would make portamenti and sing, and the cellist, my teacher Casado, you know, was oh my god, he used to slide everywhere, up and down and in and out, all different kinds of slides, right? So we should try and find, yeah, I'm going to give you a big upbeat, are you ready?
Yeah.
And the upbeat is for the audience as much as for the oh, did you notice she breathed out? That was wonderful. She went, is that great? And she sets a fantastic mood as a result.
Yeah. Thinking about it.
Yeah, great, wonderful. Here we go. Yeah, rather than once again. Also, you do da di da. Too much bow on that. Use only as much bow as you need, not as much as you have.
Okay.
You got that?
Yeah.
All right, here we go.
Mm-hmm.
what's going to happen? I don't know this lady, but I watched her while you were playing, and she was touched to the core of her being. She was just completely transformed by your playing. Was that right? Yeah. And that's what music can do for us, isn't it? It's an incredible thing. Now, what you did was, just let's find out what it really was what you did. You took a faster tempo, yeah, and it seemed slower.
Yeah.
Because there were fewer impulses. Mm-hmm. So for the musicians in the audience, if something is boring, play it faster. Not slower, because if it's boring or if it's stuck, move it faster, and then you'll find another level at which we experience the music, which is one in a bar. You got that?
Yeah.
And it gave you infinite freedom, and you'll never do it the same way twice. Mm. That's not the right way of doing it. It opens up a way of playing that is... And look at that face now. I mean, just look at that. You see, that's no longer somebody going into a competition. That's somebody who's discovered the key to life, right?
Yeah.
Right. Isn't that right? There's nothing to do about winning a competition. Look at those eyes. I mean, she's so alive. And that is a beautiful discovery, that we can touch people directly. No other form of communication can do that. You can't say something that will cause that reaction. You can't dance or paint or sculpt or anything. Only music can do that.
Yeah.
And it goes directly. It doesn't go through the brain. It goes directly through the molecules. It's really, it's an amazing thing. And you just touched on that. And you have a fabulous orchestra.
Yeah.
And she got it completely, because it's like pulling elastic. When you pull the elastic and you let go, it goes back into the original tempo, which has always been there.
Mm-hmm.
So you notice you could stay on that high E as long as you wanted, because you knew that when you came back, it would go back into tempo.
Yeah.
Isn't that a beautiful discovery?
Yeah.
So the secret of that is one in a bar. If the people's toes are beating in three, you haven't got it.
Yeah.
Right. If they're beating in a half, well, you can't divide three into a half. But if it's six divided into, in other words, it's six beats with one impulse, isn't that right?
Mm-hmm.
Over two bars. If you've got that, then you can play with it as much as you want. And whenever you let go with that pulsating, wah, bah, 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 it'll move. Isn't that beautiful?
Yeah.
A great discovery. And, you know, as far as I can tell, this is the best response to the tragedy in Paris yesterday, is to make music like that so people feel in touch with their humanity. Also, I noticed this gentleman, I mean, he lives in the midst of this terror in Israel, you know, where every day people are blown up. He's not surprised by what's happening in Paris, because in Israel it happens daily, so it's normal. Right? But we still have that capacity to be moved, to be touched, to be enlivened, to be open-hearted by this music. And Elgar had that capacity. It's a beautiful, beautiful thing. But it has to be one in a bar. It's a technical thing, and it's interesting, because we musicians have to understand how our music works in order to touch the people who don't know or care how it's done. You don't care whether it's one in a bar or three in a bar. You don't know anything about that. Although you probably noticed that when I was conducting, this feeling of... instead of... da, 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 di, da, di, that doesn't do it for us. Isn't that amazing? Yeah. So it's a technical thing. What happened to you is... miraculous, because you became physically free. You became what I call a one buttock player. You know what a one buttock player is? A one buttock player is, because this is the normal way you play cello, you need two buttocks to sit on a chair like this. But if you play the cello, you can go one buttock or the other buttock. And you're a one buttock player. But not the first time. The first time you were stuck on two buttocks.
Yeah.
Right, because it was too square.
Yeah.
Right. You got that? Right. So now this is something for your whole life.
Yeah.
And if you have a pianist who's not as great as Dina is, you're going to have to teach them how to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And there you have to be really clear about it yourself. If you hear them do this, one, mm-hmm. two, three, they say, no, there's only one beat in the bar, and ideally one beat in two bars. Ideally one beat in two bars. Isn't that amazing? And human beings can hold that. Just do that opening one more time. So here's the tempo. Do the tempo, the real tempo comes here, here, here. So this is one body to your. And you see two bars. Just hear that. No, one bar. Two. One. Right, that's the tempo. Now, if you did that at the beginning in that tempo, it would sound like this. Do the beginning, it would sound. nobody would be interested in that. If you played that way, they'd run to the box office to get their money back before it closed, you know. But with that tempo, you can still do that and be very free, like in one in a bar. Even that you could time a little bit more interesting. It was a little boring. So, just feel the tension of those semitones. Once again. Good. And there's something else I'd like to point out, so the people who are not musicians feel this, learn to feel this. Things in music are usually built in threes, always in three. So you get the first phrase, the second phrase, and the third phrase. Now, it can be either one of two things. It can be it can be one, two, three, where the third one is the most. You do one, and then you do two, and then you do three. Or I, you, and we. Those are the two main ways. So either you have or So which is this?
I think the first option.
Well, it isn't really, is it? Because look, they're identical. Da dee da dee. And the third one is the one that takes us. And the we is like including all of humanity.
Oh, I see.
In that way. Yeah. Just try that once again. And now we got one beat for two bars, and then another beat for two bars, and the third one includes all of humanity. Ready? Two, and... Includes this. Beautiful. And now the. That's one in a bar. There's one and two, and now the third one. Thank you. I'm just going to tell you something about competitions, because you're about to enter a competition. And competitions are useful, maybe. They may produce money or reputation or opportunities or something. But when it comes right down to it, competitions are completely meaningless. Because as you were playing, I was saying to myself, this is just as beautiful as Jackie Dupre.
Right. Wow.
Just as beautiful. And of course, we rightly have heroes. You know, Jackie Dupre owns this piece. I mean, she played it. Everybody knows her performance of this piece. But it's no more beautiful than your playing. No more beautiful. And when you play that way, we're riveted, we're engaged, we're in love. We give our hearts to you, and there's no hierarchy, there's no nothing, there's no competition.
Yeah.
You understand that?
It wasn't even in my mind.
Not in your mind for a moment, thank goodness. Unfortunately, in our life, we are dogged by competition. I mean, even these young ones, you know, they're thinking, did the grade they get at school better than somebody else? You know, all a grade is, think of this, all a grade, somebody gets a grade, all it's saying is that Johnny is better than Margaret. That's all it's saying. It's not saying anything else. Johnny's better than Margaret. It doesn't mean anything. It's a completely meaningless idea. So what means something is when you touch somebody's heart, and so on, as you did every single person in this room just now, without any question. So let's do the last movement, because you've got to play that. Great, wonderful. But we don't want you to stop playing that movement. Now hold on to it. That's great. Let's have a little applause. Yeah. So, Marza, the first thing I want to say to you is you've made unbelievable progress. Because, you know, I heard you 2 years, two years or 3 years?
4 years.
4 years ago. amazing. I mean, you've become a great cellist, and that's a wonderful, wonderful thing. Incidentally, if you're worried about dropping your bow, my teacher, Cassado, was going to give his debut in Paris when he was 11. But his father suddenly decided, no, we're not doing that, you're going to study. And so he went to study with Casals, and he finally gave his debut when he was 19. And by then, Cassado was his name. He was the great cellist of the next generation. Everybody was talking about him, Dvorak concerto. And so the big, long introduction, Salle Pleyel in Paris, everybody was there waiting for the great master. And he took his cello and he went the B major chord at the beginning, and he went, bah, and he threw his bow into the 11th row of the audience. Anyway, you're a great, great cellist, and you're wonderful, and you're going to have a fantastic life. I know that. You're going to have a great life, a great career. Everybody's going to want to play with you. So I have very little to add, but I will tell you this one thing. You come from a Latin perspective, and many of the greatest interpreters of Elgar's concerto were Latins. Casals, Tortelier, many of the great, great people. They brought that Latin quality. Elgar was English. And there's something very different about English, the English style. And he was a very unusual English. For one thing, he was a Roman Catholic in a Protestant country. He was married above his station. You know, he came from a lower middle class. He was married to somebody in the upper middle class. That's unthinkable in England. He was an outcast. So he had a very dark side to him and a very tragic side to him. But he remained very English, and that means an outward appearance of control and nobility. The word that he used most often in his music was nobilmente.
Yeah.
Right. So you play like a Latin, but more grand, more noble, more head held high, and with a certain kind of severity, great beauty, great feeling, but controlled. You can imagine that somebody running the common, you know, the empire.
Yeah.
Right. It's that control, pomp and circumstance, yeah. All of that. So that was better. Do it one more time. Very noble.
Thank you. good.
Right, great. You're wonderful. You are, because you're a great actress. You're putting on a completely different character, which is great. And there's nothing wrong with the Latin approach, but this has a real English feeling. There's something else about the English. They love humor. They love humor. Falstaff. So this is a little Falstaff. So play with it. Be playful. Do from right there. Da 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 ding.
Thank you.
Don't want to break the mood a moment. Bravo, 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 bravo. Beautiful, 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 beautiful. It's an incredible thing that happens in this piece because he comes back to that mood of the slow movement, and you got it in One in a Bar, and it was incredibly moving, fantastic. But of course, if you've been really rambunctious in English and full of that humor and so on, that's incredibly touching. This is the last piece he wrote, the last orchestral piece he wrote. He wrote other pieces after this, but this is his farewell. Mm-hmm. And there's no doubt that, that what he's expressing there in the end is his farewell to life, farewell to his wife, who he adored, and his loneliness and his sense of being outcast, of not ever quite being accepted into the world that he wanted to be accepted into. And there's a beautiful, very English kind of, not sentimental at all, but a great longing, a great yearning, farewell taking, deep sentiment. There's a huge difference between deep sentiment and sentimentality. Yeah. Sentimentality, you draw attention to the emotion. Look how emotional I'm being. In sentiment, it's just absolutely genuine. And no composer was more genuine and authentic than Elgar. And in this style, very, very, very beautiful. And I think that I was going to interrupt you, and then you were playing so beautifully, I didn't want to interrupt it. It was so beautiful, but I think that when you get to this dark farewell music, it can be even more both restrained and committed. I don't know quite how to express it, except I know you can do it. So would you just do that final section one more time? And it, again, it depends enormously on the timing of the here from here. It's from the... Right. Let's just do it from there. Do it so. No, wait, wait. He has one whole bar.
Oh, sorry.
Can I suggest there, when you have that, and the second one is again, not too slow, in other words. Thank you. I don't care whether you win the competition. I don't care. I think you probably will, but it doesn't matter. But what you did is you won the parts of the people in this room, and that's all that matters. Yeah. That's all that matters. You really did that in an amazing way. And it's not about being better than anybody else or compared to anybody else or measured against anybody else. It's just you giving your soul.
Yeah.
And you gave an English soul rather than a Latin one, which was great.
Thank you so much.
But it was beautiful. Well done. Now, the test is the eyes. Look at those shiny eyes. Look, even these kids. Look at that shiny eye. Look at this one. My God,
shiny.
Look at that. You see, that's all we care about. We don't care about the check at the end or the review. We don't care about that.
Yeah.
We care about the eyes. And if the eyes are shining, that's what it's for.
Thank you.
Well done.
Thank you so much.
Beautiful.